So back when I was a teenager, I became deeply interested in reincarnation. That belief about the afterlife that is found most notably in several Asian religious traditions. I've always been fascinated by religion. Probably doesn't come as much surprise to you. But when I was a teen, I was fascinated by the idea that after you die, you might be reincarnated, reborn into some other life. So back when I was a teenager, I would daydream, kind of daydream about reincarnation. And when I did that, is it all right if I have a little confession here? When I daydreamed about the possibilities of my own reincarnation, it was always a daydream of being reincarnated into a life that was every bit as good as the life I was living, but with a few features that might be better. I'd fantasize about being reincarnated into much the same life, only I'd be reborn a little taller, darker, and more handsome, and more popular, or better sense of humor. Or perhaps wealthier, or I'd be reborn with preternatural gifts of athletic prowess or artistic genius, gifts that were so evident that I wouldn't even need to work hard to cultivate them, but they would just come naturally. Looking back at myself in those teenage fantasies, there's something that's really embarrassing. It's curious that I never gave serious thought to other possibilities of reincarnation, the possibility of being reborn into a life that was harder, beset with suffering. It didn't occur to me to imagine being reincarnated as a childhood victim of famine, reborn as a refugee in a war-torn nation. Nobody ever imagines that they'll be reincarnated as a dung beetle or a tapeworm. I mean, we can imagine other people being reincarnated that way, but never ourselves. Here's one thing that I believe is true. In a cosmic sense, the chances of any of us being here are so astronomically tiny that it defies all comprehension. There is something about each and every person here that is utterly improbable. Isn't that something? I mean, what are the chances? You have a better chance of, I don't know, winning the Powerball 100 times in a row than you have of being you. I mean, we are who we are, and we can't be what we're not. But what improbability that any of us would be here as we are. There's this Dr. Seuss book that I've read to my daughter on a couple of occasions. It's entitled, "Did I Ever Tell You How Lucky You Are?" When you think things are bad, when you feel sour and blue, when you start to get mad, you should do what I do. Just tell yourself, "Ducky, you're really quite lucky. Some people are much more, oh, ever so much more, oh, muchly. Much, much more unlucky than you." When we read it, she is especially fond of the part with the pants-eating plant. See, the first service didn't laugh. They heard. You guys had a better sense of humor than the first service. It goes like this. I love those. "Be grateful you're not in the forest in France, where the average young person just hasn't a chance to escape from the perilous pants-eating plant. But your pants are safe. You're a fortunate guy. You ought to be shouting, 'How lucky am I?'" Now, I have to tell you, I like this book, but it is of dubious parenting value. It turns out that you can ask a child, "Did I ever tell you how lucky you are?" But that won't actually stop them from wanting things different than what they've got. I think back to that Jane Kenyon poem, "Otherwise," which was our reading this morning. "I got out of bed on two strong legs. It might have been otherwise. I ate cereal, sweet milk, ripe, flawless peach. It might have been otherwise. that I am telling you how lucky you are. I want to challenge us this morning to hold two very different ideas in our minds at the same time. The first idea I want to challenge you to hold is that this poem is absolutely correct, 100% accurate. It might have been otherwise. And for this, we should be grateful. As one of my minister friends puts it, gratitude is, in part, about not wishing for a better past, but being able to appreciate the present. We all have things in our lives for which to be grateful, things that very well could have been otherwise. On this Sunday before Thanksgiving, as we enter this time of the year in which our thoughts naturally turn to kind of taking an inventory of all in our lives that we're thankful for, this lesson of gratitude is worth remembering, whether it's family or friends, food, shelter, and warmth, companionship or community, we should feel gratitude. It might have been otherwise. Gratitude is good for us. I'm going to put Brian Sexton on the spot here. Brian is a psychologist who stood in the pulpit and has preached on this subject of gratitude, telling us that regular practices of gratitude, perhaps something even as simple as keeping a gratitude journal and writing down three things at the end of each day for which you are very thankful, that makes us happier, less susceptible to burnout, more resilient. I listened to your sermon, Brian. Sorry to put you on the spot. This is 100% true, 100% true that gratitude is good. And there's also a second thought that I want to ask you to hold. There are instances when this way of thinking isn't actually helpful. There are instances when this way of thinking isn't actually helpful. Let me explain. I recently came across these words written by a therapist, and these words struck me as true. She said, quote, "As a therapist, let me just say, almost every trauma survivor I have ever had has at some point said, but I didn't have it as bad as some people. And then talked about how other types of trauma are worse." She goes on, "Even my most traumatized, most abused, most psychologically injured clients say this. What does this tell you? That one of the typical side effects of trauma is to make you feel that you are unworthy of care. Don't buy into it," she says, "because it's nonsense. It doesn't matter if someone else had it worse. Every person who experiences a trauma deserves to get the care they need to heal from it." The psychological term for what this therapist is describing is minimization, the treating of something as if it has less importance and significance and seriousness than it actually has. The opposite, perhaps, of catastrophizing, which some people do as well, which is treating things as being of much more importance and significance than they have. But minimizing is this strategy of taking things that are uncomfortable and distressing and then diminishing their importance in our minds as a form of self-protection. Does this make sense so far? So what this therapist said, this therapist I read, is really interesting to me. She said that it did not serve her patients well when they took the painful and traumatic things in their lives and shrugged them off by saying, "Oh, I don't have it as bad as some people." According to her, this wasn't helpful to their healing and well-being. We could all come up with lots of examples of minimizing on display in our world today. Minimizing is especially harmful when it's used to excuse or ignore injustice, inequality, oppression. And I can give you examples of this, and they're uncomfortable. I mean, could you imagine going down to the homeless shelter here in town and saying, did I ever tell you how lucky you are? I mean, homeless people in India, they got it much worse than you. Perhaps saying to a woman, "Did I ever tell you how lucky you are? I mean, if you'd been born 100 years ago, you wouldn't have even had the right to vote. So don't complain about sexism today. That's ugly. Such an ugly thing to say." I hear hear this way of thinking all the time, and often it drives me nuts. The fact that a person could think of a more racist time, a more sexist culture, a less democratic regime, a nation with worse poverty, may not be used, should not be used, must not be used to excuse the oppression that exists in our time and in our place. There's a concept from Buddhism called Tonglen, and that concept is the ability to stand in the face of suffering without being moved to minimize or to try to avoid it. I think we all have that experience of being in a hard place. And then somebody perhaps may trying to make us feel better might say, well, count your blessings. Really, one of the people in my life who spoke words once that just made me cry, that had gone through a tough time, and I had said later, kind of reflecting back, oh well, other people had it a lot harder than me, and he looked at me and he said, it was hard for you too. And those words just melted my heart. Dr. Seuss writes, "You ought to be thankful a whole heaping lot for the places and people you're lucky you're not." Well, yes and no. These two diametrically opposed truths I invite us to hold simultaneously. Thank God, because it might have been otherwise. And don't dare tell me how lucky I am. You with me so far? I want to conclude today by talking about a different understanding of otherwise. Not otherwise in the sense that things could be worse, and not otherwise in the sense that things could be better, but otherwise in the sense of this experience of being different in some ways, and how that experience may be a blessing to us. One of my earliest mentors in ministry, former Unitarian Universalist Association President John Buren, once preached a sermon, a quite good sermon entitled On Being Otherwise. He began that sermon with a story about going to what was billed as an interfaith gathering, and when he showed up, he was asked at registration, "So, are you Protestant, Catholic, Jewish, or otherwise?" He said, as one John said, I think I'll go with the otherwise. They sound more interesting. Have you ever had that experience of being otherwise? Have you ever had that experience of being otherwise, which is to say somehow outside of the standard categories? Have you ever felt that experience of being otherwise? When was it? When was it in your life that you felt that way? When was it that you felt otherwise? I think a lot of Unitarian Universalists have that experience of feeling otherwise, kind of spiritually and religiously, of feeling like we're outside of the boxes, the categories, the standard definitions. I hear this when we teach the Exploring Membership class, Rachel and I, and people tell their stories of, yes, I started out this way, but not quite fit, and then I went over to this thing, but that wasn't a fit, and now I'm here, but I'm also sort of here. A lot of people find themselves as being otherwise. And the gift of being otherwise is that it can help to make us otherwise. That experience of being otherwise can help us in our lives to be more inclusive, more compassionate, more understanding, but also tenacious in sticking up for the marginalized and the excluded, tenacious in sticking up for the excluded and the persecuted. Here's a story that I love, a story that happened about 20 years ago in Montana, in Billings, Montana, at this time of the year, kind of entering the holiday season. And at that point in Billings, Montana, there were a number of anti-Semitic hate crimes, of rocks being thrown through windows and threats against the synagogue. And people in the community got together, and there was this response. A bunch of people decided they were going to drive over to the hardware store and get a whole roll of blue and white lights and take down kind of the multicolored Christmas lights that they were putting up, and just put up blue and white lights and put a menorah in the window. And this caught on. And soon everybody started in the community, everybody with a good heart in the community started trying to kind of outdo each other by decorating their houses for Hanukkah as a way of saying, like us too. And the newspaper in town, the newspaper in Billings, Montana, even read as its centerfold this kind of newsprint-sized menorah that you could color in and hang up in your window. And that December, there was hardly a house in Billings that wasn't celebrating Hanukkah. That ability to be otherwise, it's that otherwise that actually leads us to develop in our hearts a sense of compassion. The word compassion from the Latin actually means to with passion, with suffering. The word compassion actually means to suffer with, to suffer alongside. One day, I know it will be otherwise, says the poet Jane Kenyon. One day, I know it will be otherwise. Our response should be one of gratitude and hope and compassion. Amen. Closing hymn this morning is one of my favorites. It's one that we don't sing very often. Number 86, Blessed Spirit of My Life, give me strength through stress and strife, help me know serenity. It's a song about actually feeling that sense of gratitude and then responding to it with acts of goodness and justice. So I invite you, as we close our service, I invite you to rise in body or in spirit and maybe sing out our closing hymn number 86, Blessed Spirit of